Today will be the talk is titled Object-Oriented Programming in Python. First, we'll see or understand what object-oriented programming is, and then we'll see how we can implement or write object-oriented code in Python. Okay. So first, let's try to break down object-oriented programming. What is object? Then what does it mean when we say object-oriented? And then finally, programming. Okay. So in very layman terms, object is nothing but a collection of data and associated behavior. This might look very vague, but actually the concept itself is very vague as well as widely applicable. So if, for example, I am an object, I have some data associated with me, and I can perform some actions or some behavior. So if I have a name, I have some height, some weight, some blood group. Okay, these are all the data points or attributes associated to me. Now, behavior is I can listen to music, I can watch Netflix, I can eat, I can drive, I can run. All these are behaviors or operations that I can execute or perform. Okay. So anything which has data associated with it, some data or attributes are associated with it, and you can also have some behavior that becomes an object. So your apple, orange, is an object because it will have some weight, it will have some radius, and it will have some color. Then your every book is an object because every book will have a title, a author, some identification number. So anything with data point and behavior is an object. Okay. Now, what do we mean when we say object oriented? If you look at the dictionary meaning, oriented basically means directed towards. So with object-oriented programming, what we are trying to do is, given a complex problem statement, we are trying to model it in form of objects where these objects interact with each other or communicate with each other. Okay. So if I want to design a complex software or I want to design a complex system, I'll break it down into objects, small objects, and now these objects can interact with each other to perform the expected task. Object-oriented programming is basically a way of describing a collection of interaction between objects via their data and behavior. Okay. Again, this might look very vague, but once you start practicing it, once you start writing a few lines of code, all these words will start making sense. But the idea is, once you're you get like involved into software development, you'll realize that the code base can be really big. Say 5,000, 10,000, 20,000 lines of code. And there, understanding everything won't be possible. Writing everything, creating the logic of all these things as it is won't be possible. So to make it easy, make it manageable, make it reproducible, we basically try to break down our problem statement. We try to break down our problem statement in form of objects. And then we see how these objects interact with each other so that it becomes very easy. Now, a single person or a single team can work on a couple of objects, and they just have to make sure that these objects are working fine. It also becomes very easy to test. So it's kind of a mental model when you are writing big softwares. Okay? It's just a framework to make your code more manageable and more like reusable. Okay? But not just object-oriented programming, there are many different approaches, but object-oriented programming is one way which is quite popular and is very aggressively used in software development. Okay? But remember, there are many other mental models for developing big softwares. Okay? So a few basic terminologies that you should know. First is class. Second is what do I mean when I say data? And third is behavior or operations. So say, for example, there's a every person is unique in itself. Okay. Now, but all these persons will have some common attributes. So your class is like a template that you use to create an instance, which is an individual person. So for example, like when I say blueprint, I basically mean a template. Okay. So लोग बोलते हैं पैसे छापने की मशीन है, राइट? सो द ब्रिक और द मोल्ड दैट इज यूज टू प्रिंट नोट्स, इट्स द सेम, बट ईच नोट विच इज बीन प्रोड्यूस्ड विल हैव इट्स ओन सीक्वेंस नंबर विच इज डिफरेंट. ओके, सो दैट टेम्पलेट जस्ट गिव्स यू द आइडिया कि वॉट द एक्चुअल ऑब्जेक्ट और द फाइनल प्रोडक्ट विल लुक लाइक, बट ईच ऑफ दिस फाइनल प्रोडक्ट विल हैव देयर ओन यूनिक वैल्यूज. ओके, सो एवरी पर्सन, यू, मी, आमिर खान, शाहरुख खान, ऑल दिस पीपल आर यूनिक इन themselves, बट वी पुट देम इनसाइड अ कॉमन क्लास कॉल्ड पर्सन. ओके, सो टू रिप्रेजेंट अ सिंगल काइंड ऑफ ऑब्जेक्ट्स वी यूज दिस आइडिया ऑफ क्लास. नाउ ऑल दीज ऑब्जेक्ट्स will have some data associated with it, which will represent some characteristics. They are also known as properties and attributes. And finally, all these class will have some behaviors. Now, in object-oriented world, these behaviors are called methods. And methods are not very different from functions. They are exactly the same, but somehow these methods have access to all the instance variables or all these data points which are described here. All these methods will have direct access to these data points that are associated with that object. Also, these methods can take extra parameters and can also return values, just like your normal function would. Okay. Okay. So. Where was I? We were talking about methods. So methods are nothing special. They are just functions. They can take arguments, they can return values, and they can perform certain operations. But only thing that they have special, only thing that makes them special or different from your normal function is they have access to these data variables or these data attributes, properties which are associated to that object. Okay. So these are some basic things that you should know. I know it's very vague, but once we start writing code, you'll understand it better. Today we'll be discussing classes and object. We'll look at instance attributes and method. We'll see what are class attributes and class methods. We'll also discuss static methods, and then finally we'll discuss inheritance. Now Python in true sense is not an object oriented language, so all the concepts like encapsulation, polymorphism, all these things are not widely applicable when it comes to Python. In Python, there's no way of defining private variables and so on. There's no way of polymorphism is built into the language, so you don't have to do anything explicitly to implement polymorphism. So we won't be discussing the complete object-oriented landscape, but we'll be keeping things limited or restricted to what is allowed and what works or what is required in Python. Okay, so great. First, we'll have to frame a problem. So status bar collapse. Okay, so first we'll have to define a problem that we'll try to implement. Now the most logical or the most the example that I end up using the most is designing a Counter-Strike game. Okay, CSGO. I assume all the boys know about it, and all the girls, they might have heard about CSGO from some boys around them. Okay. So it's basically a first person shooting game where we have two teams. Each team will have five people, and the task is to kill everyone in the other team. But there are two teams, terrorist, counter-terrorist. You have to plant bomb and other people have to defuse bomb. But the simple idea is there are two teams. It's a shooting game and you have to make sure that you kill all the people from the other team. Okay. So now let's see how it would look in an... So if we want to implement CSGO, let's think in terms of objects that we'll be needing, then how these objects will be interacting with each other. First thing that we need is a team. will have two such teams. So each team will have 5 players. Now, each of these players can have some inventory with them. So they can have gun, they can have grenades, they can have flamethrower and other stuff. Okay. So each player will have some inventory with them. Each player will have some health and so on. So our player is an object. Now these players will be interacting with each other throughout the game. So one player will be shooting, the other player will be taking some damage. The one player will be throwing some throwing grenade and or flash bomb, and other player will be getting affected by it. So the complete game is about interaction between these players. Okay. So instead of writing it or directly writing code for it, it would be much better if we handle it through object-oriented programming, or we frame it as an object-oriented program. Okay. So let's see how we would do this in Python. Okay. So to create any class in Python, we simply say class, then we say the name of the class that we are going to use. This can be anything that you want. One common convention in Python is to start the class name with a capital letter. And if you have multiple things, so say player name, so you are supposed to use camel casing. Okay. So every word will have the first letter capital. Okay. So I'll simply make it player. Okay. And then I'll say pass. This is a simple class in Python, which does nothing. So I can say player one is equal to player. Now to create an object from a class, we just have to call the class name with these extra brackets. Now this is same as calling a function, but Python knows that I'm not calling a function, but I'm actually calling a class because we have defined the class above. Okay. So what this will do is it will return a Python object. It will return a player object. Okay. So let's see player one. So this is the player object that we have. This is the memory where it's stored. Okay. Now this player object doesn't have any data attribute associated with it, or it doesn't have any method or function associated with it. But this is how you can create a new class in Python. Okay. Now in Python, it's quite flexible and you can assign data points or attributes at runtime. So I can simply say player one dot name, and I can assign some name, say Kira, and then if I say player one dot name, I'll be able to access it. Okay. So I have defined this attribute outside the class, and I can define many more attributes, but it would be a tedious task. We want that every player that is created, he should already have a name, he should already have some inventory with him, or he should already have some health. Okay. So to do that, we use an initializer. Okay. An initializer is basically a method which is always called when you create an object. So there's a special name for initialization method in Python. It is called init. Now all the methods in a class will always take self as an argument. You don't have to think about it. You just have to pass self in all the methods that your class has. There are some exceptions to it, and we'll be discussing them later on. For now, every method that I'll be creating, I'll be passing self. Okay. Next is, I want this method to take name as an argument. I want this method to take health as an argument. And then I'll say self dot name is equal to name, and self dot health is equal to health. Okay. Now, so what we are doing here is, once I have defined this class in this way, as soon as I'll run this thing, okay, I'll get an error that init method missing two arguments which were required. One was name and second was health. Okay. So just to So as soon as you create a class, this method will be called always. So this method expects these three arguments, but self will be passed automatically by Python. So you don't have to worry about self. You just have to take care of name and help. So I'll say name equal to Meera, and then help will be 100. Now if I print the name of the player, it will be Kira, and if I print the health of the player, it will be 100. Just to make this point more concrete, I'll say print, and I'll say player created, and here I'll say name. Just to show you that this function is called as soon as you create the class, I have added an extra print statement. So as you can see, player Kira was created. So this function will be called automatically by Python. You don't have to call it explicitly. So all the attributes that you want, or all the data that you want to be present or associated with your class, you will be passing those values here, and then inside this is what you will be doing. Okay. Now self is a very special argument. Okay. Because self always indicates that particular instance of the class. Okay. So I'll just make it more clear. So you have a class which is like a template. Which is like a template. Now, using this template, you can create objects. And methods for that instance. Okay. So yeah, this is very confusing in the beginning, but as you use it more frequently, you will get used to it. So yeah, you can define other methods as well. So I can say method run, and here I'll simply pass self, and then I'll say int. And then I'll say the instance variable, I'll have to always use self. Self.name is running. I'll create this object and I'll call it run. Now run takes one argument, which is self. So we don't have to pass self. It is done automatically by Python. So we'll simply call run, and this method will be executed. If I create another player 2, so how many of you have seen Death Note?
Yes, sir, I've seen.
Okay. So these are basically names from that anime.
Yeah, yes.
So if I say player, player 2 dot run, and you will see L is running. So whenever you call run method, you can see it's calling self dot name, which is basically take this instance and what is the name of this instance or name attribute for this instance. Okay. This is what it is doing. So to get access to this is what I was talking about, that this is a method. Now this method will have access to all the instance data points or attributes by through self object. It's the standard which is used, but you can use anything. So I can say me. Okay. And here, instead of this, I'll have to write me. whatever is your first argument, you have to use it throughout. So I can run this and I can also run this. It will work. It will work, but generally in Python, this is the convention self. So I'll stick to it to not cause confusion. So these are your data attributes and these are your methods. Okay. Now, this is the very first thing that you need to know. So if your player has some other operation or some other action that it can perform, you can define a new method for it. So I can define shoot and it will take self object and then I'll again add a print statement for the same. Instead of this, I will say shoot. So this is how it works. And this is all about classes and then objects. And self allows you to access the data points for that particular object or instance of the class. Okay. And all the methods, class methods, will take self as an argument. That is by default. Even if you miss this thing, it will give you an error that a run takes zero positional argument, but one was given. So here you have not specified self, but whenever you are calling player one dot run, it will by default pass self argument, or it will automatically pass that particular object. Okay. So you'll have to include self here. Okay. So am I audible now?
Yes. Now audio.
Okay. So, yeah. Sorry about the internet issue. So, this was about creating class and object. Okay. Now, there are some values that you want to store within a class and not the object itself. Say for example, every player will have a team that he belongs to. So I'll say
Sorry to interrupt, but are you sharing your screen? Because I can't see anything.
Okay. Yes. Can you see the screen now?
Yeah, now it's visible.
Okay. So, say there are some attributes or some values, some data points that you want to store about the class itself and not associated with a particular object. For example, you have, say, continuing with the same example, you also want to save the team of the player. One thing that we can do is simply have a team argument here, self.team, and I'll say terrorist or counter terrorist. Okay, instead of that, I'll use 0 or 1, okay, to indicate terrorist or counter terrorist, so that it will be like more useful, team 1 or team 0. Okay. This is one way of doing it, but you can have an attribute like number of players. So I'll say n players, which will show how many players are still alive. So every time a new player is created, by default it will be 0. Every time a new player is created, I'll increment it by 1. And every time a player is killed, I'll decrement it by 1. So this variable, for now, I'll just show you how you can access it. So this name variable, this is not n player variable. It's not associated with any object. It is directly associated with the class. So now I can directly say player and then n players. And I'll see 0. Okay. But I cannot access n. Won't work. Okay? Because this is a method for the instance. That is, you will first have to create the object to run this method. Also, you cannot access any of these variables. You'll have to first create an object, then only you can access it. So I cannot simply say person.name. First, I'll have to specify what person am I referring to. Okay. But if there's some class method like nPlayer, then I can simply say person population in India. Okay. Or person, number of persons in this house or in this nation. So for that, I don't have to know a single person, or I don't have to have access to that single instance. Okay. So these are our class methods, class attributes. Now, you can create, I'll use smaller gay. You can also create player, and I'll use the same thing. And when you create a new player, you can do player dot n players. Okay. Now, this is an object, but you can access all the class methods as well. Class attributes as well. So I can either access it directly. So I'll show you all the possible ways of accessing it. I can directly access it from the class itself, or I can create an object and then access it. Now, the object doesn't have this variable, but I can still access it because of something called MRO, method resolution order. So I'll simply say help and p1. So help is a Python function which actually gives you the documentation or the source code of anything that you pass. So as you can see here, that this is my class method, okay, and now this is the init method. Then I have defined something called run, something called short, and this is my data or other attribute which is defined in the class. So now this can be accessed by not only the class but all the instances of that class as well. Okay, and to access those values here, I'll define. Okay. So, before we introduce a new concept, just make sure that if you want to define something which is associated with a class and not particular instance as such, then you will have to define it here. You don't have to define it inside init. You don't have to use self, but you will have to define it like this. All these are class attributes. Okay, you can access them by directly calling class name and then the name of the attribute, or you can create a new object and then you can, all the objects or instance will have access to this class attribute. Okay, now if you want to use this class attribute inside the class definition itself, so this is how you do it. One is, we directly say, okay, every time this thing is incremented, so I'll say every time a new object player is created, I'll simply say n player x equal to 1, and then I'll take this thing, I'll paste it here, and was created, and here I'll say n player. Let's highlight it. So okay, so if you see that it doesn't have access to this, okay, here you can directly access by passing class name and then the name of the data point or attribute, but inside this it doesn't know what it exactly that method is. So have to do this, we'll have to do player dot player is okay, we'll have to do this. So now if you'll see, every time I create an object, now this is one, and if I create another object called player 2, I'll paste it here instead of Kira. I'll use Joey, and this will be my player 2. You'll see this number is incremented. Okay, so to access class variables inside the class definition itself, you will have to use class name and then the name of the attribute. This is very important, and like this is how you are supposed to access. You cannot access it directly, because if you look at it this as a function, then self is passed as an argument, hence you can use these things. Name is passed as an argument and health is passed as an argument, hence you can access all these values, but apart from that you cannot access anything. So if you directly say n players, it doesn't know kahan se aa raha hai wo. So you will have to say ki I'm accessing n player from this class called player, and it has this class attribute called n player, so I want to access the same. Okay, so this is how you define a class attribute and this is how you access it. Now let's try to implement the second half. Say f, and player can die. So I'll do self, and here I'll simply print self dot name. Okay, I'll click this, write this, and then I'll say player dot n player minus equal to 1. Here I'm decreasing the count whenever a player is dead. Okay, so as you can see, this attribute is associated with the class and it has nothing to do with the actual instance as such. Okay, so these are your class attributes. Making sense? Hello.
So how do I define that, you know, this is something that I should define as an attribute versus this is something that I should define within the function? like within the method.
Okay. So, anything which has nothing to do with the class actual object itself but is important. So that should be like, this is a very vague definition, but say for example, if you have records of say 10th class students. Now, all these students belong to the same class, which is 10th, right? So 10th can come here as a class attribute. What is the class name? And all the students, because I know I'll be like using this class, so the class name will be. Now this is very obvious that all the students which are instanced of this class will belong to 10th class. So I can define this here, but imagine there's another situation where you are recording all the students in the school. Under such circumstances, class name should become an attribute of the student itself. So there's no rule of thumb or ground rule or ground truth that this attribute should always become a class name or an attribute. It depends upon the problem in hand. It depends upon the context that you are trying to address or you are trying to write code for. But generally speaking, if it has nothing to do with the instance, you won't be needing it. But still you want to keep track of certain things which are as such related to the class and not particular instance. So you'll make it a class attribute and not a object attribute. So with more example, this intuition will build, and there's no right or wrong in it. It's oftentimes it will boil down to your preference or choice. Okay,
thank you.
Can a class name and a function name be same?
I have not tried, but yeah, like it can be same. Like I don't see any problem with it, because anyways we'll be calling while creating the so let's see. I'll say I don't think which problem hoga, because at the end of the day it's will be they belong in the different namespace, so problem nahi hoga kuch. Some dummy text, okay. And here again I'll write player, and then when I'll be calling it, I'll be saying p1 dot player, and it will work because these two things belong in the different namespace. I can only access this through an object, and whenever I'll be calling an object, I'll have the object name and this, but you cannot do this. This is not allowed. Like you cannot do this. Because now whichever this will be like overwriting something, okay. So print other text, you cannot do this, because what this will do is first it will create a function with name player, and then as the code executes, this will end up writing that function into a class. So if I take this thing and add it here to the end, and if I do this, so you'll see an error because player doesn't return anything. Okay, two arguments were given, but it takes zero argument because this function has overwritten this class definition.
Okay.
So defining outside is not allowed, but inside you can have. In Python, this is the general convention: start with a capital letter, and for methods and functions, start with a small letter. Next time somebody uses your library or uses your code, even without actually looking at the source code, he or she will know that you are talking about a method or a class. So yeah, this was about class attributes. So we have already seen classes and objects, we have seen instances and their attributes, which are basically associated with this thing called self, and we have already seen methods. So these are all the methods which are instance methods and not class methods. Okay, then next thing that we saw was class attributes. This is how you define them and this is how you access them. Next was like if we have class attributes, then we should also have some class methods. Okay, so again, these are very same, but like depending upon the problem in hand, it will be always a matter of like intuition or preference whether you define something as a class method or a class or as an instance method. Okay, so since we already have seen what are class attributes, we'll see class methods. But before that, I'll like to give an example. So whenever we are creating a player, this is what is being called under the hood by Python. Player dot, and then I can access any internal variable like this, right? This is a class attribute. Now to access a method, I can always call this, right? But here I'll have to pass, like if I do this, I'll get an error because it takes three positional arguments. I'm calling what is, like I'm taking this class and calling this method inside this class, and it will take three arguments. So I'll have to pass the object itself, okay? And then I'll have to pass the name as well as the attribute. So whenever, so this is how it will be. Say toss and 100. So this is what Python will do under the hood for you. Now if I check player one dot name, you'll see it's Ross. So whenever you are calling more than this, a better example would be p1.run. One positional argument, but three were given. So I can call it like this. Another way of calling the same thing would be directly calling run. Okay. So under the, when we call this under the hood, this is what Python does. It will say player class and call the run function on this object. But when we run this, it already have access to p1. So it will know ki I'm calling this run function on this object. Hence, we don't have to pass it explicitly. But when you call this run method as a class method, then you will have to pass the object yourself manually. We don't ever use this syntax, but just for you to know ki what is happening under the hood. Python will automatically understand ki we are calling run method on this object. But if you don't specify the object itself and you specify the class, then you will have to pass the object manually. Okay? And this is how Python automatically takes care of self method. Okay, so this init method is also called. This init method is also called by Python, but it is done under the hood when you are doing this. Okay. And in the init method, you don't have to pass self, like because you are directly calling class, and along with this, this method will be automatically called. Okay. This won't work, but just to give you an idea, okay, this is what is happening under the hood. Great. So now we'll see how we can define class methods. So to define class methods, we'll have to use @ and then class method. This is called a decorator in Python, and they somehow wrap your function into some other code which adds extra functionality to your function. Okay, so don't worry if you don't know about this thing, but you will have to use this decorator if you want to define a class method. So here I can say reset. Okay, so if I say reset, now all the class methods will take class as an argument by default. So just like here, these are your instance methods, and helps we pass self, which will give them access to the object. But here we are passing class, so this will give me access to all the class variables. So I can say CLS. Now again, this can be anything that you want. The reason I'm not using class is because class keyword has its own meaning in Python. So generally people pass CLS, but you can pass anything, just like we have done for self. I can call me, I can call this class or anything, but this is the Python notation or convention, so we'll be using the same. So I can say class, and then I can say L player equal to 0. Here, since class is passed as an argument, I have access to all the class variables, and hence I can directly access these attributes. Here, I didn't had access to class variable, so I had to call the class name manually. Okay, so let's see it in action. If you see for now, player dot n players, this is 0. I'll create a new method, a new player. I'll create another new player. Player 2 was created. Then I'll say P3 is equal to player and Ross with say 150. So he has also bought the armor as well. Okay, so you'll see more and more new players are created, and total we have 8 players now. Now I can simply say player dot reset. Okay, so we were talking about class methods. So you can access all the class attributes as well as class methods by directly calling this class name and the method, or class name and the attribute. Not just this, but you can access all the class methods and class attributes through the object themselves. Okay, so you can say p1.reset. You can also say p1.nPlayers. But you cannot directly call the object method from the class. So calling player.run won't work. Okay. Calling player.1 won't work because you'll have to specify the instance that you're supposed to use. But player1 already knows the parent class. Okay, I'm generated from this class or I'm an instance of this class, and hence you can directly call. Okay. Guys, it would be great if somebody can unmute themselves and keep giving me some audible feedback so that I can know that I'm not disconnected, because the Wi-Fi is behaving quite weird. So I'll at least know if people can hear me. Great if anyone of you can volunteer and help me with.
Yes, we can hear you, Uncle.
Great, Manoj. So do let me know after every couple of minutes.
Okay. Sure.
So this was about class methods and class attributes. Now, one very common use case of class methods is calling passive or indirect constructors. So this is how it works. I'll say class method, and then I'll say def, and I'll say from string, and I'll say class, and then I'll get a player. So now what I'll do is say my player string is basically one big name. So I'll just show you. This is how the string will be. I'll say Kira and then 100. Instead of passing these two things as separate entities, I'll be simply doing this Kira space here. So what I can do is I can say name comma health space. I'll split on space. So the first token will be name, the second token will be health. And another thing that I want to do is I'll say health is equal to int and then health. And then I'll simply say cls and I'll pass name comma Now I can basically create a player by just passing a simple string. So I'll create three new players. You can see the number of players has been updated. Now here, what I'll do is, since this is a class method, so I can access it directly. So I can say player and then dot, and then I'll say from string. That basically means I'm creating a player from string. And my string will be, this CLS argument is automatically passed by Python itself. So my player string will be Monica and 100. This will return me a player called 4. So player 4 was created. Now I can see 34 dot Monica. So now this is like a indirect constructor. So it will take some random thing, and then it will bring it to the format that your class expects, and then we simply say class and call it with brackets. This is how we create objects, right? We say the name of the class and then we pass the arguments. Here we have access to the class variable as CLS. So instead of calling player like this, we'll be calling CLS and then name and health. So these are also known as indirect constructors.
Okay.
So let's check. So I'll show you where it's used. Like, so oftentimes these concepts are quite vague and it can be difficult to understand when to use it or when to define something as a class, a variable or object. The best way to learn these things would be to read source code. That will give you a really good understanding of how things are done in practice, and you can ask questions to yourself why it is done in a certain way and why not the other way. While finding answers to those questions, you will end up getting a better understanding of things. Okay, so date time is one package. Then there are many other libraries. I don't know pandas whether it will use it, or there's something called pathlib which I guess uses it. So we'll also check the source code for that as well. Okay, so this is all the source code for date time module. It is like 2500 lines of code, but don't worry a lot about it. We'll just check some ideas that we discussed and then we'll get back to Okay, so I'll say class method. Okay, so if anyone of you have already used date time, then this is how it works. Okay, so 800 line. Now this is there's this class called date, and if you want to create a date, then like these are the argument that it takes: year, month and day. Okay, so this is how date time works. Now to create a date from timestamp, there's this class method, and this is what you are doing. You are simply passing a timestamp t, then I'll call underscore t dot local time, and then I'll pass timestamp. So what is this underscore time and then local time? This might be another class which is defined above. If I pass t, which is our time, to this function, it will return us all these things. So basically, it will take the timestamp and split it into year, month, day, hour, minute, second, weekday, and I don't know what is this J day and DST. It will break it down into all these things. And now I'll take Y, M, and D and pass these things here. I can also call, simply call my, I can call date dot today. And this is what it will do. It will basically call time dot time, and it will return a class object T. And then I'll call class dot from timestamp, which is this function, and I'll pass this timestamp T. Okay, so like this is how your date time function is able to create date object from all these different formats. One is from timestamp. You can simply call today. You don't have to pass anything. It will automatically go and check the current time along with the time zone and stuff, and then it will pass the current time to this method. There's another thing called from ordinal. There's another method called from ISO format, from ISO calendar, and all these methods. And if you'll see, all these are class methods. So let's see it in action. So I'll say import date time, and then I can simply say date time dot date dot today. This is a date today. Okay. I can pass any other timestamp as well, and if I'll be doing that, I'll have to call from timestamp. So these are all the different ways of creating the date object. Okay. And this is how it's in practice. Okay. There's this another library called Pathlib. Uska bhi source code yahan pe hai. You can go and check how it works. If you already have used the library, so you will be in a much better position to understand ki what this library does and how to use it. The code is not very big, 1600 lines of code. Control F, class method, and okay. Anything defined with underscore, don't worry much about it. Okay, so I can simply say CWD. It will call the class method with this argument. So it will get the current working directory. If I called home, then it will basically call get home directory. Okay, so this is how class methods are used in practice. So they are basically your indirect constructors. Great. So I'll delete a lot of code that I don't need anymore. So I'll just say p dot. Okay. So this is one very common use case of class methods. If you go and read any library's code, you'll end up seeing a lot of class methods for defining for creating a class. Great. Now we have covered class methods, and there's one last type of method called static methods. Now static methods, you don't need them as such, but Python has still provided you, because other language have these those methods. Okay, so static method, just like class methods, you use this argument called at static method, and then you define a method. So I can say random start game. It doesn't take anything. It doesn't have to do anything with the class, or it doesn't have to do anything with the instance. So static method called. Okay. So I can to call static method, I can simply say player dot the static method. So here I'll simply call it and it will be executed, or I can simply call them from the individual like instance as well. So this is very similar to class method. So a lot of people confuse between static methods as well as class method, but important point to remember is this static method doesn't have to do anything with the class or the object itself. Okay, hence nothing is passed by Python. If you remove this thing, this automatically becomes a instance method. It will give you an error that self was expected here. But as soon as you specify that it's a static method, Python will not pass anything, and hence you won't get any error. Okay, so we have already seen an example where we simply I have to call, because player one is still the previous definition. I have not executed the code. So static method, I don't know, it's not working. I can directly call the static method, but I cannot it takes zero positional argument, but one was given. Okay, so if you are calling it from an object, it will give an error because Python will try to pass self here. Okay, and hence you have to use static method as a decorator to tell Python that this is going to be a static method. So the automatic question arises is, if this method has nothing to do with the class or the instance itself, why do we add them or why do we include them? Okay, so the most common use case of static method is, say you have a bunch of methods which are not related to each other, but they don't use the same data. Okay, or the functions, say there are a lot of functions which are related to, say, geometry, drawing shapes for graphical user interface. Now all these functions are very different. If you want to draw a square, a rectangle, or any other thing, all these functions are very different from each other. They don't have any shared knowledge between them or variable between them. So a good way to organize your code is to create a class like this shape and then define all the methods inside this. I'll say static method, and then I'll say def square. And then I'll say print. And this is the way where I'll define all the methods here. I'll say everything is a static method. And now, instead of square, I'll say rectangle. Paste here, I'll say circle, copy, paste, and here I'll say triangle, copy and paste. Okay. Now this arrangement basically allows me to organize my code by combining methods or also by combining functions which will come under a common namespace. So if I want to use these things like square, rectangle, this is how I'm supposed to call them: shape dot square. Okay. So this is how you call them. So that this static method idea allows you to organize your code. So you can create a class for shape which will have all the functions which are related to shape. Okay. You can create another class which will do calculations. I can create a class called operations, class operations, and here I can define one static method which will do addition, another static method which will do subtraction, multiplication, division, flow division, power, and all those things. And then to call these methods, I'll have to use operation dot add or something of that sort. So static methods are generally used to bundle or put functions together inside a class so that they fall under common namespace. this is not the only use case. Oftentimes you also add static method to your like class, which will have class methods as well as other instance methods as well. So this, an example of static method inside this class would be, say, okay, take this example of starting the game. Okay, now here you want a static method, say, okay, so we are building this CSGO game, right? This is a player class. Now to start the game, to exit the game, to show who won the game or who lost the game, all these methods will come inside a single class. Then it would be much better, because you can simply say gameEngine.start, gameEngine.end, gameEngine.declareWinner. Okay, all those different type of things. But there are many cases where you can have static methods inside some other class. So one good example of this is, I think sklearn metrics method should use it. Metrics should use it, because all those metrics are independent of each other, and they should work fine if like okay. Can I see the source code? So there's this like folder called metrics. It will have all the classes, like all the metrics for different types of problems in hand. So if you go and check classification, like supposed to use them, like as a, like nobody is forcing you to use them. Okay, you, another easy way of like replicating the same effect of this square dot a, another way of doing the same would be create a new file, and okay, so I'll rename the file, I'll say shape.py. And then I'll copy all these functions from here to here. I'll remove this, 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 and I'll fix the indentation. This will give you the same effect. All I have to do is I'll have to say import shape. And then I can call shape.square and so on. So it's not compulsory that you have to use it, but this is how of this is how static methods are used often. Okay. So basically, to combine methods, or sorry, functions, which logically make sense to be together, but they don't share anything. Okay. So yeah, that was static methods. Last thing is inheritance, and then I'll give you some tips on how you can build this habit, or some practice exercise to do next. Okay, so inheritance is a very powerful construct. It's a very powerful way of like writing your code, making it more and more reusable. So we have already defined this class called player. Okay, so what I can do now is I can create another class, okay, which will be a subclass of this player class, child class of this player class. So I'll simply say terrorist, and then this will take player. Okay, this has to be small, hence it was not highlighting. And I'll simply say pass. I'm not defining anything. But if I create terrorist, fine. Now you can see that it's saying that init argument requires name and health. I have not defined anything here. it's when I say whatever, like this is how we read it, we are defining a new class called terrorist, which will inherit from player's class. Okay, this is as good as taking all this code. This is as good as taking all this code and pasting it here. I'll copy all this code and if you paste it here, this is what inheritance is. So it will automatically take everything that was there in the parent class and you'll get all those definitions for free. So oftentimes we define a base class and then we start inheriting from that. So you can have a currency, or you can have, like, often used example is employees. Now you can create an employee class. Now there can be a manager, there can be a marketing guy, there can be a sales guy. So you will define employee as the base class, and then for manager you will say like this class. I'll say manager, which is an employee. So it will inherit all the properties of an employee. And for marketing person, you will say sales, and then you will say employee. So all the properties, all the attributes, all the methods in employee will be directly copied, and then here you can define things that are specific to manager. So manager will have people working under him, so it will be list of all the other employees that are working with him. Okay, sales team will have some extra attributes, like what product is he selling. Not every employee in the company is selling something. Okay, then we can have another class called software developer, and then he'll be an employee as well. Okay. So for developer, we'll have what projects he is working on, what clients is he looking after, those sort of things. So here let's define a few more things. Like if he's a terrorist, then okay, I'll say def init, and I'll pass self, I'll say name, and I'll say health, and then I'll simply I don't even have to do this, like this is completely fine. All I have to do is pass the name of the person. I can also do this terrorist from, I have not defined anything, but I can simply write. So can anyone name a terrorist? Okay, like anyone from friends who can be said terrorist? Any suggestions?
Action.
Sorry?
Phoebe.
Okay. This is right, like this is how you spell Phoebe. There's something. H-O.
Gandhar will be more suited.
Okay. Gunther. I don't know. Like, how do you spell Gunther?
E-R.
Okay. E-R. Gunther. And I can do a 20. This will also work. So just by calling this thing here with extra pairs of bracket, can use all the functionalities of player, plus I can define some new functions here. So I can say this will take self, and then I'll say print, and then say self dot name hunting. Oh. I can call t1 dot plant bomb. I have to call this function. So Gunther planting bomb. Now if I say p1, then p1 will not have this function, and hence the error that player object doesn't have this function, but terrorist object has. So you can now keep adding more and more functionalities to your child classes. Another thing is you can overwrite a lot of things. So say instead of this method, instead of writing this, we can overwrite this thing. Like instead of this method, I can say my run method for terrorist will be different. So here I'll simply say p and then name and then this person is. So I'll say t1 dot run, and this will have an extra t here to indicate that it's a terrorist. Okay. So, and if you don't override the run function, then default run function will be used. So this is how it works. I'll simply say help and then I'll pass t1. So this is the method resolution order, which is MRO. First, whatever you ask it to do after dot, whatever function, method, whatever you call, first it will try to check inside terrorist. Okay. So if this class has this or not, the run method is present. So this method will be executed or called directly. If it cannot find those methods or attribute inside terrorist class, it will go and check the parent class. And if it cannot find that class in the parent class also, then it will throw an error. This is how like it will be resolved. So if I say p1 dot some random method, it will give an error that terrorist object doesn't have this attribute, because it cannot find random method in terrorist, it cannot find a random method in player, and this is built-in object which has a lot of very basic stuff, like it's not usable, so you can completely ignore it. Okay. So when this method resolution order becomes very important when you use multiple classes or multiple parent classes. So instead of just inheriting from parent, you can inherit from multiple things. Instead of just inheriting from player, you can inherit from many other things. Say I'll also inherit from employee. Doesn't make much sense, but just to give you an example, you can inherit from employee and so on. So it will give you an error that employee is not defined. So let's define employee class. This will be very basic, okay, so that we don't get the error. But now if you look at, okay, I'll create this thing. Now if you look at this is how it will be resolved. First it will look in terrorist, then it will look in player, then it will look in employee, and then it will look in this. So this order is very important. If I change these things, if I keep it here, then the order will be changed. Now you can see first it will go and check employee, then it will go and check player. So you can have multiple parents. This is called multiple inheritance, and there's also something called multi-level inheritance, where you inherit from player and create terrorist object. Now there will be some other class which will inherit from terrorist object, and then the inheritance level will be like much deeper. Here we have only two class, but you can have many more classes, and that will be called multi-level inheritance. And this is multiple inheritance because you have multiple parent classes to inherit from. So there, this is an advanced topic where you will have to resolve if both the parents have same methods. So this is how Python will resolve. If it will find run method in employee, so first this will be executed directly. Their run method will not be executed. Okay. So yeah, like this is how inheritance works. This is a bit of an advanced topic, but you'll quickly get used to it. So great. I'll quickly revise what all we have learned, and then we'll see how you can practice and start looking at softwares through object-oriented perspective. So first thing that we learn is what are classes and objects. So class is basically a template for how the instance will be created. Okay, but instance or object are that particular objects are particular instance of these classes. So they'll have all the unique values. Being unique is not important, but they'll have specific values. So person is a class. Shahrukh Khan is instance of that class. Salman Khan is an instance of that class. You and me are instance of that person class. Okay. So we'll have our own attributes. We'll have our own behaviors. So these attributes and behaviors are called instance, attribute, or methods. Similarly, you can have class attributes and class methods. So this is how you define class methods. Class attributes. To access class attributes, you directly use the class name. And if there's a class method, you can simply get away with CLS argument. Okay. And to define a class method, you will have to use class method decorator, which tells Python that instead of passing self object, pass the class itself. Okay. Now, both class methods and class attributes can be accessed by directly calling player name, then the class method or class attribute. But you can also access them through these instance. So I can say p4.nPlayers, or I can say p4.fromString. Both these things will work. Okay, because class methods are accessible from object or instance as well. Last type of method was static method. Static methods are the methods which have nothing to do with the class itself or the object itself, but logically it makes sense for the person who is going to use it. Say you have a class called currency, and there's a function for giving you changes. So if you say 720 rupees, so given the denomination, it will return ki kitne note dena chahiye aapko. 500k, then kitne aapko dena chahiye, 100k, and then kitne aapko dena chahiye, 10k, 20k, 5k, and so on. So now logically it will make sense to the end user if we can have this function inside our currency class. Okay, so you can simply define a class called currency. You can have all the methods, instance method, class methods, attributes, etc. inside it, and you can also define a static method which will be called denomination. And whenever you call denomination, it will not take anything. Denomination method will not take denomination. This will not take anything. As soon as you this will take the amount. This will take amount. As soon as you give it the amount, it will directly see the maximum possible number which you can divide it with, say 500, and then it will see the how many 500 notes do we have to give, then remaining amount, then what is the maximum possible divisible, and so on. Okay, so logically, since it makes sense, so we put them together. That is one use case of static method. Class methods are also used as indirect constructors. Indirect constructors. So these are all the things that we have discussed. One last thing was inheritance. Inheritance basically allows you to inherit everything from the parent class without defining anything. So this allows you to define a base class and then inherit that base class to get all the functionalities and extend those functionality by either overwriting those functions or overwriting those methods or class methods or like instance methods. Or you can create new class methods or instance method in the child class itself. Okay, so these are all the things that we have covered today. Now, one very good way of developing your object-oriented skills in any language is to actually go out and look how it's used by other people in the community or how it's used in the real world. That is one of the best ways to learn something new. So say for example, it's not very difficult. As we have already seen, there's this pathlib object. If you already use it, you will know what this library does and how you can use it. But say there's something called collections in Python. So I'll say Python. I'm assuming a few people have used it. Okay, so this is the base class. It will have all these things. And here you can see that we are creating an ordered dict, which is inheriting from dictionary, Python built-in dictionary. Okay. Now, what I'm doing is I'm overwriting the init function, and I'm overwriting this function, set item, delete item, iter, reverse, and clear pop item, and all these functions. I'm just overwriting these functions, and So this is order dict. Once order dict is defined, then we will define something called name tuple. Don't worry much about it. We have this method called counter. This is again a dictionary, and then what we are doing is we'll take the init method and then missing values, most common. So we are adding these extra methods in this counter method, class elements, and then there's this class method. So you can say create it from keys. So I'll basically pass an iterable from its keys I'll be creating it. Okay, so it's not implemented yet, so this is the error that you will get. For update, this is how it works. Subtract, this is how it works, and so on. Okay, so go out and try reading the source code for a few libraries or a few few small libraries that you use on a regular basis. Most of these built-in libraries are very well written, well documented, and oftentimes you use them. Okay, so I'm not sure how many people use Pandas, Scikit-learn, or Flask or Django, all those libraries, but I'm very sure that a lot of people might have used datetime library. A lot of you might have already used collection. Some of you might have already used pathlib and all these libraries. These built-in libraries will always have the best practices in Python. These are written by some of the core developers, so they know the ins and outs of the Python programming language, and they also know what is the best way of doing something, what is the most optimum way, most logical way, and most Pythonic way of writing something. Okay, so when you read the source code of these built-in functions or these built-in methods, you'll end up understanding things better. You'll learn the best practices. Like, it won't be a mystery for you anymore whether to make it a static method or instance method, or to make it a class method. Okay, so that mystery part will go away once you start reading these codes. Okay, now one last thing that I would like to share is, like, next thing, like, one is going out and reading source code. That is one of the best way to develop a good understanding of the subject. Another good way is to start implementing small functionalities to the things that you want your library to do. Say for example, I have this dictionary. Okay, so I can create a class called log. I'll say log, okay, and I'll inherit from dictionary, which is Python dictionary. And what I'll do is I'll simply say def init, okay, and then I'll say self. And next thing that I'll do is I'll simply say print, and more than this I'll say from pathlib import path. Now I can simply say path dot current working directory. This will give me the current working directory. I'll save it in p1. Now, to list all the files that are present, I'll have to call iter directory, and then I'll have to call it into a list. So now it will give me list of all the files that are present in this directory. So now what I can do is I can create a new class called path, which will inherit from the path which I have imported here, and then I'll say def ls, and this will take self, and here I can simply add this logic. I'll say return list, then self dot iter directory. Okay, so basically take the current object and call iter directory on it, and then convert it into a list. So I have extended the functionality of my basic path object. So I'll import it again. I'll extend the functionality, and now if I create path object has no attribute flavor. CLS dot flavor parse a. Okay, shayad I might have to call. Hey, this should work. Let me check. No, I don't want to overwrite the. I don't want to overwrite the init method because. Okay, let's see. Def init self. Then I'll get a path string, and then all I have to do is I'll have to call super, and then I'll call init, and here I'll pass path, and let's see if this thing works. Path object has okay, for some reason this is not working, but ideally it should have worked. I'll have to check, but you can simply take any class and extend or add new functionalities to it by simply using this. I'll share the code on Discord how you can add this ls functionality. So this is how it will work once you have made all these changes. You will be in a position to create a new path object simply by calling path, and okay, all this code will work. So you will be in a position to create a path object, and then you can simply call p1.ls, which will list or return a list of, which will return a list like this. Okay, this is how easy it is in Python to extend functionalities of existing classes. You can simply inherit from it and then pass like add new function new methods to it, as easy as that. Okay, so yeah, these are the two advice that you should practice. One is try to go and read the source code of many built-in Python libraries. They are pretty well written, and you will end up learning a lot while reading those source code. And next is try adding those extra functionalities to existing libraries. Trust me, it won't break anything. Okay, even if you do this, things are not working, you can simply go and restart the kernel. It will not break anything. Okay, so try playing around with it. Try adding more functionalities to it. Try adding static methods and other stuff. Try playing with class methods and so on, but you will end up learning a lot. These are two advice to get a better intuition of how object oriented is used out in the real world. Okay, so this was quite a long session. If any one of you have any questions, I'll be happy to take them, and else we can sign off for today. I'll share some resources for you to read, and also I'll share how to add extra functionalities to the code.
Thanks, Ankur. This was quite helpful, especially with the self thing that you explained. I used to be always confused with what is happening over there. So,
okay.
Yeah, there were a lot of small things that I like. I use pandas, scikit-learn frequently, but there were certain paradigms that used to confuse me a lot. So yeah, it did help some of this addressing those small things.
Thanks. Thank you. So wherever you are using self, it basically means you are talking about the instance which is being generated and not the class itself.
Right.
Anyone has any more questions? Yeah, for anything to add? Okay, great. So that was all that I had for today. A few things that you should do next. First, go and read the source code. Second, try adding extra functionalities. Also, search like Google about method resolution order, what it is and how Python resolves it. And if you have encountered something new, try solving it. Here I wrote something called super. So your try googling about what is super in Python. So that will give you some more insight. And if anything was completely new, Google about it and drop me a question on Discord. I'll be happy to like help if you don't have any questions now. Yeah, baad mein bhi kuch questions aate hai, so I'll be really happy to help. So great. From now on, stop wondering about how a library works. Best thing you can do is go and read the source code. Okay. If you are using pandas, how is it defined? The best approach would be to go read called pandas Python GitHub and see how the complete code is structured. You might not understand everything, but it will be a really good practice. You can go read. This is the pandas source code, actual code, baki sab kuch for documentation and other stuff. You'll see like this is everything that is there. APIs, array, then core, and all this plotting test time series. You can go check core. Core will have a lot of different things. So there's something called dtypes, group by, index, and a lot of other things. So pandas is quite a big library. So don't jump directly, but yeah, from documentation you can navigate very easily. And if something looks cryptic now, it is always the best advice, go and read the source code. Worst thing that can happen is you won't understand anything. Before attempting it, you didn't understand anything anyways. Okay, so aisa kuch nahi hoga ki you will be so afraid after reading the code that you will start stop using the library. Aisa nahi hoga. Okay, worst thing that will happen is you will try to read it aur aapko nahi samjhega. Anyways, pehle bhi kuch samajh mein nahi aa raha tha how the code works internally. So it's fine, but never be afraid to read code. So, chalega. That was all for today. I hope everyone was able to learn something, take something away, and hope everyone will like won't be intimidated or object oriented won't look mystic or cryptic to anyone anymore. If you still have any doubts, I'll be really happy to help. And this is a big topic, so it will take some time to get used to. So, it's completely okay if you don't understand everything. It's completely okay. So, yeah, keep learning, keep growing, and everyone stay at home, stay safe. And yeah, that was all that I had for today. So thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye everyone.
Bye-bye.